Last week, we saw some new advances in the field of science and technology around the world. Let us discuss some of the significant updates one by one. Apart from being the hottest planet in the solar system, Venus also has an atmosphere that is 92 times denser than Earth's and constantly experiences sulfuric acid rain. But as we have learned from several surveys, Venus has once a much milder climate and also had vast oceans on its surface. But how much of its water did Venus hold on during this massive transition? According to research presented by Moa Persson of the Swedish Institute of Space Physics, only a small part of the historical water content on Venus has been lost to space over the past 4 billion years to a runaway greenhouse effect. This is much less than researchers previously thought. The thesis is built on analyses of how the solar wind affects the Venusian atmosphere and causes atmospheric particles to escape to space. The studies are based on measurements of ions in the vicinity of Venus. On average, 2 protons escape from the atmosphere for every 1 oxygen ion. This indicates the loss of a water molecule. Persson analyzed data gathered by the European Space Agency's Venus Express spacecraft. The thesis shows that the number of escaping protons varies over the solar cycle. More protons escape during solar minimum than during solar maximum, because many protons return to Venus during solar maximum. Persson was able to extrapolate the escape rate of water from Venus's atmosphere and found that up to 0.6 meters of water would have been lost across the entire surface of Venus over the past 4 billion years. In other words, the results she obtained showed that the current escape process for hydrogen and oxygen ions at Venus cannot account for the loss of its surface water. The results of the thesis can be compared to similar studies of Mars and Earth to get a more comprehensive picture of the solar wind effects on planetary atmospheres. Scientists using an instrument aboard NASA's MAVEN spacecraft have discovered that water vapor near the surface of the Red Planet is lofted higher into the atmosphere than anyone expected was possible. Reporting their finding on November 13th in the journal Science, researchers said that Mars continues to lose water today as vapor is transported to high altitudes after sublimating from the frozen polar caps during warmer seasons. The new study conducted by Shane W. Stone, a doctoral student at the University of Arizona, suggests that the warm summer temperatures and strong winds associated with dust storms help water vapor reach the uppermost parts of the atmosphere, where it is broken into its constituent oxygen and hydrogen. The hydrogen and oxygen then escape into space. Stone and his team tracked the abundance of water ions high over Mars for more than 2 Martian years. The researchers measured 20 times more water loss than usual over 2 days in June 2018, when a severe global dust storm enveloped Mars. The team estimated that Mars lost as much water in 45 days during this storm as it typically does throughout an entire Martian year. The initial elements of NASA's Lunar Gateway are facing cost overruns and delays, primarily because NASA has changed the requirements of the program since awarding contracts last year. NASA awarded a contract to MAXR Technologies in May 2019 for developing a power and propulsion element, which will provide power and electric propulsion. In July of the same year, NASA announced its intent to award a sole source contract to Northrop Grumman for the Habitation and Logistics Outpost, which will serve as a habitation module and docking node. Since the contract awards, NASA has changed the requirements for the overall Gateway program. The most significant change was NASA's decision to combine the PPE and HALO modules and launch them together, rather than launching them separately and have them dock in lunar orbit. According to NASA, the decision will save a lot of money by putting those together on a single launch vehicle, as well as knocks down both technical and operational risk for the program. A November 10 report by NASA's Office of Inspector General concluded that delays to the program created by these changes make it unlikely that the Gateway will be available to support the agency's planned 2024 lunar landing on the Artemis 3 mission. The report also raised concerns that the combined module stack might be too large to fit on commercial launch vehicles. The report stated that NASA's current estimated launch date for the modules is May 2024. However, to be in a position in lunar orbit to support an Artemis 3 mission in late 2024, the Gateway modules would have to launch no later than February 2024. Therefore, the report concluded that the Gateway program must compensate for a shortage of 9 months of schedule to meet the required launch date, which is likely impossible. NASA released an independent review report Tuesday, indicating that the agency is now ready to undertake its Mars sample return campaign to bring pristine samples from Mars to Earth for scientific study. The agency established the Mars Sample Return Independent Review Board to evaluate its early concepts to return the first samples from another planet. The campaign requires three advanced space vehicles. NASA's Perseverance rover, which is more than halfway to Mars following the launch in July, consists of a sophisticated sampling system to cache rock and regolith samples in its collection tubes. It then leaves them on the Martian surface for the Fetch rover to collect and deliver to the Mars Ascent vehicle, which then launches the samples into orbit around Mars. An Earth return orbiter then rendezvous with the samples and take them in a highly secure containment capsule for return to Earth. The review board interviewed experts and made recommendations to address potential areas of concern regarding the program. NASA has agreed to address and study all of the board's recommendations in the next year, as it moves through early formulation efforts, well in advance of the agency's confirmation decision. A team of astronomers recently discovers clues that unveil the mystery of fast radio bursts. Fast radio bursts are powerful millisecond duration radio waves coming from deep space outside the Milky Way galaxy. Since the bursts were first discovered in 2007, astronomers from around the world have used radio telescopes to trace the bursts and look for clues on where they come from and how they're produced. The two most debated sources of the bursts are gamma-ray bursts and spinning neutron stars, also known as pulsars. The gamma-ray burst-like models predicts a non-varying polarization angle within each burst, whereas the pulsar-like models predicts variations of the polarization angle. Astrophysicist Bing Zhang and international collaborators recently observed some of these mysterious sources, which led to a series of breakthrough discoveries. The team observed one repeating FRB source and discovered 11 bursts from it. 7 of the 11 bright bursts showed diverse polarization angle swings during each burst. According to the team, the observations essentially rules out the gamma-ray burst-like models and offers support to the pulsar-like models. Yet, many open questions remain, and the theories should be reviewed critically in the years to come. After examining an incredibly bright burst with optical, X-ray, near-infrared, and radio wavelengths, a Northwestern University-led astrophysics team believes that they potentially spotted the birth of a magneter. Researchers believe the magneter was formed by two neutron stars merging, which has never before been observed. The merger resulted in a brilliant kilonova, whose light finally reached Earth on 22 May 2020. The light first came as a blast of gamma rays called a short gamma ray burst. The burst unleashed more energy in a half second than the sun will produce over its lifetime. After NASA's Neil Gerald Swift Observatory first detected the light, scientists quickly enlisted other telescopes, including NASA's Hubble Space Telescope, to study the explosion's aftermath and its host galaxy. Compared to X-ray and radio observations, the near-infrared emission detected with Hubble was 10 times brighter than predicted. When two neutron stars merge, the most common predicted outcome is that they form a heavy neutron star that collapses into a black hole within milliseconds or less. But it's possible that, for this particular short gamma-ray burst, the heavy object survived. And instead of collapsing into a black hole, it became a magneter, a rapidly spinning neutron star that has large magnetic fields. Follow-up radio observations may ultimately prove that this was a magneter, leading to an explanation of the origin of such objects. The team's findings appear in an upcoming issue of the Astrophysical Journal. Coming to last week's rocket launches, China has successfully launched their Tiantong-1 telecommunication satellite on Thursday. Tiantong-1 is an S-band mobile communication satellite developed by the Chinese Academy of Space Technology. In geosynchronous orbit, the satellite will provide mobile communications services, including mobile data and multimedia services, around China, the Middle East, and Africa. United Launch Alliance successfully sent an Atlas V rocket into space on November 13. The 63-meter rocket blasted off from Space Launch Complex 41, carrying with it a classified payload for the National Reconnaissance Office, which manages the U.S. government's fleet of spy satellites. The satellite provides optical and radar imagery of Earth from space, as well as to send and intercept secured communications to various intelligence agencies.